Today is the 3rd of May, 2017. We are at the New York State Military Museum in Saratoga Springs, New York. My name is Wayne Clark. Sir, for the record, would you please state your full name and your date and place of birth, please?
Kevin Francis Shepherd, and I was born in Rockville Center, New York.
And your date of birth?
Date of birth is October 10th, 1948.
And did you attend school there?
I did. Limbrook High School, graduated from there in 67.
And at that point, did you work or did you go on to college at all?
Right after high school, I had a job for a short period of time, and then I was drafted in the Army roughly about 7 or 8 months after high school.
All right. So you were drafted into the Army.
Right, sir.
And where did you go for your basic training?
I went to Fort Gordon, Georgia for my basic training, and consisted of 8 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
And
was that your first time away from home?
Yes, it was.
Okay. Was there anyone in basic from your hometown at all? Or?
Yes, there were two of my classmates that were also drafted and also went at the same time.
And once you graduated from basic, where did you go for your AIT, and what was your AIT?
My AIT was advanced infantry training, and I went to Fort McClellan, Alabama for that, and again 8 weeks of training. Mm-hmm. For that. Okay. And they were preparing us for being deployed to Vietnam.
Mm-hmm.
They advised us about halfway through our advanced infantry training that we were all going to be deployed to Vietnam.
And were you?
Yes.
Okay. And did you get any kind of leave before you went to Vietnam?
Yes. We got roughly 28 days of leave prior to being deployed to Vietnam.
All right. And when did you end up going to Vietnam?
I went in October of 1968.
And whereabouts did you land in Vietnam?
We landed in Tan Son Nhut Air Base in Vietnam. And at that time, our entire unit was sent out except for 8 of us. We were advised that we were going to be deployed to a different unit separate from our training unit. Mm-hmm. And we waited there for assignment.
Now, let me go back just a little bit. What was the weather like when you arrived in Vietnam?
We arrived about 2:30 in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
And it felt like it was 100 degrees, but it mm-hmm. was probably 85, 90 degrees. It's extremely humid at mm-hmm. the time.
And how long were you in Tan Son Nhut before you were sent to your duty station?
Probably about 12 to 15 hours.
Okay, so it was pretty quick.
Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right, and then you were sent where?
We were put on a helicopter, a mm-hmm. Chinook helicopter, and we were advised when we were in, on the helicopter that we were going to the 1st Infantry Division, the 4th Armored Cavalry.
And where were they located?
They were located north of Saigon, probably about 30 miles. Their base was mm-hmm. Right around there, northwest of Saigon.
Mm-hmm. And what was that like when you arrived there?
Very scary, very mm-hmm. Intimidating. The unit that we were assigned to had some casualties earlier in the week, and we were the replacements for the members that they lost. And there was 8 of us that mm-hmm. Filled in that squadron.
Okay. What was your base camp like?
We didn't have a base camp. We were a mechanized unit, so we traveled all over the all over the countryside there, mostly along the Cambodian border. We would patrol. And every 6 weeks, they would send us to a base camp where we had a little R&R, and we'd do maintenance on the vehicles and the weapons and that.
Now, when you were out on patrol, did you have fresh or hot chow, or were you living on mostly sea rations, or?
It was all sea rations, and we didn't have any hot showers. Every couple of days, a Chinook helicopter would drop fuel for the vehicles and some water and our supplies, and they would bring us some fresh uniforms. We had a 5 gallon bucket that we were able to use for taking a shower, and that was every couple of days, 3-4 days.
Okay. So you you were out there basically with the infantry also?
Many times we were assigned with infantry units also, but not all the time. With certain missions, we would be assigned with them, yes.
Now, what about contact with the enemy?
We engaged in several conflicts, being a mechanized unit, they would move us a lot. So if an infantry unit or another unit was involved in something, they would bring us there to assist. So we often saw conflict.
When was the first time since your arrival? Was it a month or 2 months or right away? Or
it was probably about a month and a half when we were there, and it was early in the morning. We were picking up Claymore mines and that from being set up, and an outpost, and we had engaged some enemy fire, and that lasted for about 3 or 4 hours.
Now, was it the NVA, or was it like Viet Cong, or?
It was the North Vietnamese soldiers, yes.
Okay. And did you suffer any casualties at all?
Not in that engagement, no, we didn't. And it was just a small force that had attacked us, but we didn't suffer any casualties then, no.
Could you actually see the enemy that you were firing at, or?
Very, very rarely. Most of the time not. They were camouflaged, and there was a lot of wooded areas and shrubbery and that, so it was very difficult, and the terrain was very rough. So they had plenty of opportunities to seek shelter and that, so it was hard to engage them.
What kind of armament did your vehicles or tanks have?
The tank was a 90 millimeter round, the main gun. And we roughly had about 60 rounds inside the tank that we could utilize. And then we had an M60 machine gun mounted on the top of one of the turrets. And then an M50 that the tank commander had, a machine gun.
That was a 50 caliber?
Yes.
Okay.
And then if we had a loader in the tank that was a fourth man, he also had a few weapons, but small handguns and RPG.
What kind of personal weapon did you carry?
A 45. I mostly drove for the first 6 months. I drove the tank, so I had we called it a grease gun, a zip gun.
Oh, yes. Yep.
And it was a 45 automatic.
So that was kind of like a leftover weapon from the Korean War, wasn't it?
Correct. Yes, it was. Yeah. But it was very, very effective, especially mm-hmm. in close combat mm-hmm. situation. It was a very effective weapon.
Mm-hmm. What was the closest point you were ever to the enemy?
Probably about 10 feet.
Really? Wow.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Were you ever wounded at all?
Not with weaponry, no.
Okay.
No, I was bit by a scorpion and I had a tree lodged up in my face at one point, but thank God that was my only injuries there.
How did this scorpion bite come about?
We were going through some thick jungle in that, and it had landed on my arm. I was driving at the time, and it bit my upper arm, and immediately felt it, and then my arm started to swell up within about an hour, and mm-hmm. I got a very high fever, and they eventually called in a helicopter and took me into a medical facility where I stayed for about a day and a half.
Mm-hmm. It must have been pretty painful.
It was, yes. Mm. But it was scary mostly because the arm swelling up so fast and got so hot. My arm got so hot.
Was it your whole arm or just the area where it
bit the whole arm.
Really?
Did swell up. Yeah.
Now, what about malaria? Did any of your guys come down with that?
Not that I'm aware of, no, but we were given malaria pills that we would take. A lot of guys had some bad reactions to them, mm-hmm. Give them diarrhea and some other mm-hmm. side effects. Fortunately, I didn't have that, but I did take the malaria pills as prescribed, and I didn't mm-hmm. contact it. I didn't know of anybody else that did.
Did you have the white pills or the orange pills or both?
It was the white pill.
Okay. All right. And while you were over there, did you get mail on a regular basis from home?
We would get mail roughly about once a week, mm-hmm. Depending on when a helicopter would come out and deliver the supplies, mm-hmm. and we would get fresh uniforms in our mail and that. Mm-hmm. So roughly about once a week.
Mm-hmm. Were you able to take an R&R at all?
I actually did. I took an R&R to Japan, mm-hmm. and I had a brother in the Air Force that was stationed in Japan, and he would go TDY to Vietnam. He was a mechanic on a C-130, and I had an older brother that was a sergeant in the Army, and he was stationed over in Vietnam, and we all went together to Japan for a week.
Oh, that must have been nice.
It was very nice.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Now, is that the brother you were telling me about that was in Germany?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. You want to tell us about the first time you saw him in Vietnam?
We had roughly about 9 months in country, and we were at a base for a week doing some maintenance work on and maintenance on the weapons and the tanks, and we had to change a tank track for the main tank,
mm-hmm.
and it takes roughly about 6 or 7 hours to do that, and we were changing it, and towards the end of the day, somebody comes and taps me on the back, and I turn around, and it's my older brother there in Vietnam, and very, very surprised. And mm-hmm. He said he transferred from Germany to Vietnam.
Now, did he know where you were and sought you out, or was it just a fluke that he ran into you?
No, he found out where I was, what unit I was assigned to, and they assigned him to the 1st Infantry Division, but they wouldn't assign him to the field because I was in the field.
Sure.
And he was in communications, so he was more or less in a command post type of situation.
Mm-hmm. And I'm assuming he made it home all right? Also?
Yes, he did. Yes.
Okay. And you spent a year and 2 days in Vietnam?
Yes.
Did you by chance ever get to see any USO shows like Bob Hope or anything like that?
No, I didn't. They did at one point pick a few of our people to go see one of the Bob Hope shows. Mm-hmm. They went back to one of the main bases and saw it, but it was just a selected few.
Mm-hmm. And when did you leave Vietnam?
I left in October of 1969.
And how much time did you have left in service at that point?
6 months.
And when you went back to the States, whereabouts did you land?
Well, we landed in Washington and then...
Fort Lewis?
No, I think it was at a an airport. Okay. There. And they had a army set up there to give us uniforms and that to fly home with.
Okay.
And so we flew home from the state of Washington. Then, and we have on leave for 30 days.
Mm-hmm.
And then I was... then assigned to Fort Carson, Colorado, where I finished out my 6 months in an armored unit.
Okay. And what did you do? I know you were in an armored unit, but were you involved in maintenance or were you a driver? Or what did you do at Fort Carson?
At that time, I was a Spec 5, and mm-hmm. I was assigned to a tank unit and roughly there for about 1 week, and a friend of mine that I was in Vietnam with, he was already over there, and he was an avid golfer, and one of the colonels on the base were looking for some maintenance people, and he called me up, and so I actually spent my last 6 months in Fort Carson cutting grass on a golf course. So it couldn't have gotten any better than
no,
that.
No, I guess not.
No.
Now, is there anything you'd like to touch on about your service in Vietnam that we missed? Any memorable experiences or anything you want to add to the interview?
Well, the amazing part for me was I was very young at the time and a little immature, mm-hmm. But came from a very solid and loving family and was never away from home.
Mm-hmm.
So it was a bit of an experience. When I was in advanced infantry training, I ended up getting sick and had a little touch of pneumonia, and I was in a hospital bed, and I called home and was talking to my mother and father, and my father got on the phone and said, you know, son, I know you're having a tough time, but he says there's millions and millions of soldiers that have gone through this experience and done very well.
Mm-hmm.
So you know, you do your best there and you can make the best of it. And that advice really helped me through my entire year there. I gave it my best effort and I was very positive. I worked very, very hard. I was rewarded. I was made a Spec 5 and through my officers that I was in the unit with. And they treated me very, very well. And
mm-hmm.
I came back and I was still very grateful for my opportunity to serve the country and very proud. And thought that, you know, we had the best army in the world, and surely we were doing what was right. And so to me, it was very positive. Again, I was very fortunate to come back and to come back with no injuries. But it was truly a great experience for me, and matured a lot in the 2 years. And,
now, when you first came back from Vietnam, did you run into any protesters at the airport or anything like that?
I did when I was in Colorado. They had a big protest on one of the campuses, called it a Woodstock West, and there's a little bit of a conflict there. And wasn't treated very well at all, but at the airports and stuff like that, no, I didn't find any problems at all. One thing that before I was drafted, my present girlfriend, she started at the SUNY Albany College, and she soon became a protester for the war, and she was against that. And when we came home, it was a little shocking to see the different variations of how people thought of the war and what they thought was going on, and that was quite disturbing. Obviously, we didn't last long, but you know, so that was a little tough time. But I just buckled down and went on with life, and was grateful, and I kind of put the experience behind me.
Now, was your father a veteran also?
No, he was not.
Okay. No. And you've got some pictures there. Do you want to hold them up?
Sure.
Tell us about them.
This was a picture in basic training.
I was going to say, if you hold that back a little bit.
Okay.
Let's see if I can zoom in on it. Okay, that's in basic. All right. Got it.
And this was a picture of a good friend of mine over in Vietnam. We had a little, this is when we were in a base doing some mechanical work in R&R, and it's one of my crew on a tank. His name was Martinez.
Okay. Have you maintained contact with any of the people you were in the service with?
No, we haven't.
Okay.
And this is a picture of the tank. I was a tank commander for quite a few months, and this was the tank that I was assigned to.
Is that right side up? I can't tell. Oops, okay. Yeah, my eyes aren't the greatest. Okay. All right. It's coming in a little blurry. Okay, got it. And you've got your Bronze Star certificate. Would you like to hold that up?
Sure.
Okay, very nice. I don't know how much I can zoom in on that, but all right. Yeah, got it. And you've got a very nice letter there from your first sergeant. Would you like to read that?
Sure, I'd be honored. This is from the first sergeant, Lee Kilgore. He was roughly my first sergeant for about 6 months to 8 months of my deployment. And he wrote a letter to my parents, and it states, during the time that I have known you, Kevin, you have established firm grounds for being known as the hardest worker in the 1st Battalion, Troop B, 1st Squadron, 4th Cavalry. Not only have I observed you extending a helping hand to others as they needed it, many other people have noticed this and brought it to my attention at the time it was happening. By your outstanding example, you have caused other men to go to that extra foot that makes men stand out when other people would have given up. This within itself is something that America should be so proud of for you. But you, Kevin, go much further than that. You were the most liked individual within our platoon. Easiest one of the men. You, Kevin, with your most outstanding size and bulk, along with the picture of physical fitness, always used your energy for the betterment of your fellow men. Your outstanding example brings great credit upon yourself, your family, and the United States of America. I am proud to say that I had the opportunity to serve with you. May I extend to you good luck always. Sergeant Lee Kilgore.
Very nice.
Thank you.
Once you were discharged, you went back to school. And where did you go to college?
I went to a community college on Long Island, SUNY Farmingdale, and got an associate's degree.
And what year did you graduate?
It was 71, 72, in between there.
Now, I understand you joined the New York State Police?
Yes. In 1973, I joined the New York State Police and served there for 27 years.
And what did you do with the State Police?
In the very beginning, I was assigned to a patrol unit out in the Riverhead Barracks, out on the east end of Long Island, and served there for about 4 or 5 years, and then went into a warrant squad in Farmingdale, again on Long Island, served there for quite a few years, and then I transferred upstate New York. Up above the Albany area, was assigned to the governor's detail, and then from that I went back on the road patrol and worked on the road patrol, and then a commercial vehicle enforcement unit, and retired in 2000.
And then you went to work for a security company, was that?
Safety and security manager for ABF Freight Systems, and I had the entire Northeast that I was responsible for.
And when did you retire from that?
In 2013.
And so you've been enjoying retirement for the past few years?
I am. Okay. I am. My hobby ever since I was 18 was the fire service. I'm a volunteer fireman for 51 years, and I enjoy it, and
Now you're a fireman, a volunteer in Greenwich?
Yes. Okay. Yes, I served there for 26 years. I'm a past chief there, and been up through the line, lieutenant and captain, and then chief of the department.
Very nice. Okay, anything else you'd like to add before we close?
I'd just like to thank you for this opportunity to do this. The most important thing for me is that I have some documentation that I can share with my grandkids mm-hmm. and hopefully soon great-grandkids, but that's something that I haven't done mm-hmm. since I've gotten out of the service, is shared that and expressed my not only my feelings, but my experiences mm-hmm. with my family. So this has given me an opportunity to document that and to share it with them too, so.
Now, how many years have you been married?
45 years.
And how many children?
Three beautiful daughters mm-hmm. and 8 grandkids.
And what's your wife's name?
My wife's name is Dale.
Okay.
And another proud thing is my youngest daughter, Kathleen, had joined the Air Force, and she spent 9 years in the Air Force, was deployed 5 times.
Oh my gosh.
And met her husband in Afghanistan. He's an F-16 fighter pilot, and they're married and have a beautiful family. And so I was very proud of my daughter, Kathleen.
And what are the names of your other two daughters?
Angela and Jessica.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you so much for your interview.
Thank you, Lynn.